First and foremost, let me thank all of you for being here today, and many of you for being here over the last 7 years, and welcome all of you, and I'm honored to say that, to the 7th New York State Animal Advocacy Day, our special day for our companion pets. And I have to say, your pets look beautiful, and you all look marvelous, as the saying goes. And you know, I see our cats and our dogs and our birds, and, oh yes, and our ponies and our snakes and all the wonderful animals here. And you know, they say cats and dogs fight, but when they come to Animal Advocacy Day, cats and dogs never fight. But here, when you're not here sometimes, you might not believe this, Democrats and Republicans fight. But this is a day which we are so enriched and so honored to have over this six-month session, where we put down our shields and our swords and we come together. It's the most bipartisan, nonpartisan day in the session we have. And it's good to take that break. It's not bad to be partisan, and all of us here are partisan. We're partisan for one goal, and that's to make sure we protect the entire family of New York State, and that means our companion pets and all our animals who are parts of our family. I think I'd be remiss if I didn't just make mention and salute all our veterans and all our soldiers who are in harm's way, because today we commemorate D-Day, as you know, for our nation. When we began to fight that battle to keep this nation and this world from darkness. And Gracie, where is she? Oh, she's over there. My wife's a little mad at me. I don't know if you've seen Gracie, but she got her military cut before we came here, her summer cut. And I think she looks great. In fact, I thought she was a little heavy until I cut the fur off her, and now I know she's in great shape, probably better shape than me and most of us. But as she's ready to fight the battle, I know over these last 7 years and much before that and in continuation, you're going to continue to stand up and fight the war we kind of have, because I look at it as kind of a war. It's a war of understanding. It's a war of not just the walking and talking, but walking the walk and getting things done. And when we see some of the things that happen, we're frustrated. And we say, why can't they change? And I'm hesitant to say this. We're in the New York State Senate, and I know the Assembly is going to do some work too, we're going to pass 8 to 10 bills today to fight this battle in the New York State Senate. Because I've convinced my colleagues that on this special day we have to show some action. But we have to pass bills in both houses to get these things done. And I don't think we've ever lost a battle. We just haven't finished all the battles we've started here. And I think we've won a lot of battles. You know, let's not forget we got Buster's Law passed. Let's not forget that was one of the first felony laws ever passed in New York State. And when we started this, for those of you who might have been at the first Animal Advocacy Day, I think we had 4 or 5 rescue groups, a couple shelters. I think we've got 30 to 40 shelter and rescue groups. And please, they're on the front line. How about a hand for all these groups and these shelters and these rescue groups who do so much for us? And in terms of the population, maybe 50 to 75 individuals. And it has just grown. And as we've grown, we've done some great education. We've got some understanding with legislators in the legislative body. Our law enforcement officials, our judiciary, our DAs are starting to understand the importance of the fact that when you abuse animals, it is a bridge crime usually. In the FBI, we can't, and we have to use this when we make that argument. Last year, put this type of crime up on an A level when individuals abuse animals. So we've got to get them off the street, and we've got to create education for everybody that makes sure they report it. And when it's reported, they go to jail and they're off the street. So in light of that, I'm just going to tell you about 2 bills which I'll be passing today in the New York State Senate, and some of my colleagues will be talking to you about other ones. I think I have it. I usually carry it somewhere here. It's probably in my desk or somewhere. The Constitution of the State of New York. And in that Constitution, they give us our rights. but not our privileges. We know what our privileges are. They're not in the Constitution. It's a privilege to have an animal. It's a privilege to make them part of your family. It's your obligation to care for that animal. We're going to pass a bill today that says if you are convicted of a felony busters law, you will lose your privilege in New York State ever to own a companion pet again. We're going to pass that in the Senate. We are going to pass a bill to double the penalties for animal fighting in New York State in the Senate today. We are going to make it 6 years potential in jail and a $30,000 fine if you're the organizer. But if you attend it, it's not going to be a $1,000 fine anymore. It's going to be up to a $10,000 fine. It's going to be a felony for just attending. You know we've passed Kirby and Quigley's law, and I'm proud to say my second week in the New York State Legislature. I believe it passed 58-2. Denise Krohn is going to come up shortly and tell you a little bit about her efforts to get this moving in the Assembly. And her Assemblyman is going to talk to you a little bit about his efforts, what he's doing over there. But we've got to get that passed, because you can't walk into a house and steal a TV or a computer or some jewelry and then shoot two beautiful companion golden doodles, Kirby and Quigley, walk out, maybe get arrested and say, have the law enforcement in our society say, well, that was just a burglary and that was incidental. Because then that's open season on our companion pets. We're going to make that three felonies, the burglary and the killing of Kirby and Quigley, if we get that passed in the Assembly. Now, Stratford 22. Is just an example of what's happening all across the state. No hydration, no food, no shelter, bringing dogs into your property, into your home, abusing them and neglecting them to death. Stratford, there was 22 dogs there in that town in Fulton County. 9 of them found dead on the property. The 10th one died later on, emaciated, beautiful mastiff animals. We got an animal shelter in Gloversville who's trying to do a tremendous job to care for those animals. Today, in the New York State Senate, we're going to pass a bill to not make that a violation, but a felony eventually for not providing hydration, food, and shelter for animals in New York State. And I want to let you know this, because you probably saw the budget and all the going back and forth on the budget. It was a $153 billion budget. But I'm happy to tell you, and that relates to small animal shelters who may be here today, like Gloversville, who don't have the wherewithal to have the necessities that they need for take care of the problems with animals. We put, for the first time, I think in the history of New York State, in the budget, $5 million for animal shelters, for enhanced construction, for more shelter space, to take care of those dogs when you have a capacity like 10 to 11. That's in the budget now, so be cognizant when those regulations are in place. Contact our offices. Will we help you fill out the applications? $5 million in the budget for the first time by the New York State Legislature, supported by these guys behind me. I think they deserve a round of applause for getting that done. What I'd like to do now is introduce two of the co-chairs. I don't think Mrs. Rosenthal is here. Oh, she is here. Okay. She's the late Mrs. Rosenthal, but she always makes it for animals. She is one of our co-chairs in the New York State Assembly, and I want to introduce you a dynamo for animal advocacy, Assemblywoman Rosenthal.
The first thing I'd like to say is I think being a senator suits Mr. Todisco quite well. I mean, we were longtime colleagues in the New York State Assembly, but when he graduated to the Senate, I got a whole new sponsor of animal legislation in the Senate, aside from Senator Boyle and some of the others who are who are very active on this. I'm Assemblymember Linda Rosenthal. I represent the Upper West Side and parts of Hell's Kitchen in Manhattan. And I'm telling now, I'm getting vibes from my cats. They're like, why are we not here? Because it's a wonderful day for people and for animals. First thing, I'd like to give a shout out to Julianne and her son, Tom George, because Julie is the one who keeps us going in the fight. You know, you have a lot of inner resources, you have a lot of community, but this one special woman, you know, we dedicate a lot of our work to her efforts. And I'm really so happy to see you here today because you mean the world to us. Thank you. So I'm proud to be one of the co-chairs this year with Assemblymember Murray, Senator Boyle, Senator Serino, and Senator Tedisco. And when I was elected in 2006, I made it one of my top priorities to do animal legislation. This was 11 years ago, and one of the first laws I passed was Companion Animal Order of Protection. And as I was discussing with the veterinarians from Cornell just recently, at the time, people said, well, animal abuse, that has nothing to do with human abuse. And now we know it has everything to do. It's a deep connection. So for those who think, well, we don't need to bother with that, it's so crucial because people who abuse animals later go on to abuse humans. And we need to view animals as our family. I know we all do. People spend billions on animals. They will go hungry before they let their animal go hungry. And so there's a new recognition in society that animals have their place at the table. Animals are still considered property in New York state law. As a matter of fact, in most law in the US, animals are property, which is why we have difficulty increasing penalties for harming animals, because it's like, well, you harm a desk, you harm a dog, it's the same thing. And so we're working hard to change that. And we have to change it in the law as well, but that's a long struggle. But in the meantime, you know, we're doing wonderful things. I'm the co-sponsor of a lot of Senator Tedisco's bills. It's a little harder in the assembly to get some of these higher penalties through, but we're working very hard to do it. And there are many bills. For example, one that I'm passionate about is to stop the declawing of cats. And you hear from veterinarians who say, well, don't tell me what to do. And I say, when you offer a supersize appointment of spay or neuter, and then, you know, we'll just cut off the first joint of your cat, I say, no, it's our business too. They don't do this in other countries, you know, and it's abusive. So that's one of the things we're fighting against. Another bill I have is to give a tax credit to those who adopt pets from shelters. Because a lot of us, you know, need some help when we take on the caring for another life. A bill to move our animal cruelty laws to the penal code where they will be taken more seriously. And a bill to create an animal statewide task force so that we can do a huge focus on where we need improvements on a statewide basis. I'm doing the Buster's Law increase with Senator Tedisco. And we're also working on a bill to have a microchip standardize the frequency so we're all on the same page in terms of that. And to require shelters to reach out and find the owners. Because it's one thing to scan, it's another to actually find the owner. And it's currently not in law that has to be done. So you know, that's one of my main efforts. I have a lot. I have like 50 animal bills I've introduced because there are endless things that we need to fix in the laws concerning animals in New York State. But I must say that it's great having these wonderful partners here, and Assemblymember Santa Barbara, Assemblymember Byrne, a new addition, and Assemblymember Ra. And as Jim said, it's a bipartisan effort. Loving animals and wanting to protect animals, I think, is the one issue that every side of the aisle can agree on. And that's because animals give us unconditional love, but it's our obligation to take care of them to the best of our ability, which means protecting them from the harms of the world, too. So I'm so glad to see all of you. There's a huge number of displays. It's amazing. I think it's because you're a senator. But really, it's wonderful to be here, and it's wonderful to meet so many old and new friends today. And I look forward to continuing in the struggle with all of you. Thank you.
You could tell there's some interest and excitement in the legislature. When I started out, there was one chair, it was me. And then we had a guy who took up the cause with me, but had done several bills before. And now we have five co-chairs. I can't wait till we have 213 co-chairs on this whole thing, and that's every senator and assemblyman. But I want to introduce to you a guy that's been out there in the front lines working for animal advocacy and our companion pets and all animals in New York State, Senator Phil Boyle, who's another co-chair.
Thank you, Senator Tedisco. And once more, let's have a round of applause for the man who started this whole thing, Senator Jim Tedisco. Julianne, Denise James, all the advocates, thank you so much for coming from all parts of the state. And my colleagues in government, I just want to mention also one of our co-chairs, Sue Serino, had a family health situation, but she is with us in spirit and is going to fight for us. And our colleague, Senator Helming, was here. And Senator John Flanagan, the leader of the majority, sends his best as well. I just want to say that we talked about some bills that we are looking at today, and my co-lobbyist here is my toy fox terrier, Olivia. We call her Livy. She's 9 years old, and realize that she's been to six of these in her 9 years, which is not bad. A couple of the bills we're going to advocate for today, and please do so. One is a bill that I have, which would require registration for rescue groups and shelters who transport animals. Obviously, the vast majority of rescue and shelter groups are doing good work, but there are a couple of questionable characters out there, and we want to make sure that the Department of Agriculture can know what these people are doing and make sure that we're working in the best interest of our animals. Also, two other bills that are on the Senate agenda today, very important. They deal with dogfighting. We see this terrible abuse of animals throughout the state and other animals, particularly on Long Island, with the gang activity. One of them would allow prosecutors to use RICO, as you know, they bring down the mafia and other gangs like that, using these RICO statutes. It would allow them to go after dogfighting rings using RICO-type statutes. Another one, vitally important, it involves wiretapping of dogfighting rings. I talked to prosecutors, and they did not even know that they cannot wiretap these things. So when they're going after these gangs, they can listen in to the wiretapping of a dogfighting ring, and they also get violence and drug selling and things like that. So it's going to greatly reduce the amount of dogfighting in our state. That being said, this bill passed the New York State Assembly already. That's very rare, and now, today, we're going to pass it in the New York State Senate. So please, all of you, advocate to the governor to sign it into law. Besides thanking all of you for coming and what you do daily to advocate for animals, I'd like to also mention a group of people that sometimes do all the hard work but don't get the glory, and that is our staff up here in the Senate and the Assembly, my staff, Susan Peterson, and all the staff that work on animal advocacy bills, so please give them a round of applause. And finally, I want you all to know, if you haven't heard, I am running for another office this year. And if I win, I'll be leaving the New York State Senate. But it's good news. because only two things can happen. If I lose the election, I'll be back up here advocating for animals for all of you next year. If I win the election, it's for the sheriff of Suffolk County. And I promise you, if I'm elected there, that Suffolk County will be among the forefront of animal fighting law enforcement officials in the entire state of New York. Thank you so much for what you do. I appreciate it.
Yeah, there'll be a new sheriff in town, Phil Boyle. Sheriff Phil Boyle. Hat, guns. You know, when I was in the assembly, I had to round up everybody. It was a little bit of work, 150 assembly members. Now I got Assemblywoman Rosenthal, and she's got a great partner. I call him Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. And here's the Sundance Kid, a guy who's been working strongly with me when I was in the assembly, Assemblyman Dean Murray, who's another co-chair.
Thank you. Thanks, buddy.
First and foremost, let me say thank you to you. This continues to grow year after year in popularity. The reason you're here, now we've heard about a lot of different bills, so I'm not going to get into individual bills. What I do want to get into is this. The reason we're here is advocacy. The reason we're here is to educate our colleagues on what is important. Linda brought up a great point. You know, when I come home from Albany, it's about a four-hour drive down to Suffolk County, and when I get home and I walk in the door, I have yet to have my television or my toaster run over and jump up and lick me and say hello. But my dogs do. They are living, breathing, caring, loving beings. And to treat them like property is just, we can't excuse that. So we need to pass these bills, and it starts with days like today. It starts with advocacy. It starts with education. I'm also, in addition to being an assembly member, I own an advertising agency in Long Island that publishes specialty publications, one of which, you might have seen at the table over here, is the Long Island Pet Lover newspaper and website. And this is, again, it's very entertaining, but it's also very educational. We talk about some of the bills we work on up here. And last year at Animal Advocacy Day, I actually hit the jackpot because I met, and Victoria, come on up, 13-year-old animal educator and journalist Victoria Bonavita was named New York's top middle-level youth volunteer of 2017 by the Prudential Spirit Community Awards, a nationwide program honoring young people for outstanding acts of volunteerism. Victoria goes around and speaks on animal advocacy and animal issues all around to other children and really does a fantastic job. She was also the winner of New York's top volunteer award, the Gracie Award. Was that named after Gracie?
Could have been.
There you go. For 2017. But I'd like to have Victoria. She is also a columnist now in the Long Island Pet Lover to help us educate. So I'd like to have Victoria say a few words.
Hi everyone, my name is Victoria Bonavita. I'm an animal educator and journalist. I go around to different schools and libraries and educate about animals. I also act as an ambassador for pets and wildlife. As a journalist, I write for two publications, Long Island Pet Lover and ET Week. As Assemblyman Murray said, it was just last year that he asked me to write for Long Island Pet Lover. I would like to thank Assemblyman Murray for that great opportunity because through his publication, I'm able to educate many people on how to care for animals. Animal abuse can often begin when people get a pet and find they can't take care of it. In many cases, they are not prepared for the commitment. Writing for Long Island Pet Lover gives me a chance to educate our readers about different animals and the commitment involved in getting one. Over the past 3 years, I have appeared on television, written for numerous publications, and I've supported many pet and wildlife websites with my educational videos. I am also very fortunate to have been invited to many schools and libraries across Long Island where I get a chance to share with the kids my educational program, Victoria's Amazing Pets. The program includes a fun and educational movie that features multiple celebrities like Jack Hanna and Dr. Jane Goodall. For my work, I was recently honored in Washington, D.C., along with the nation's top volunteers. It was so great to see that many of the honorees chose to help animals as their projects. I would like to share with you a really great line that I heard while I was there. Kids are only 25% of the world's population, but 100% of the world's future. This quote is the reason why I encourage young people to get involved in volunteering and helping the animals in their community. I would like to thank Steve Caparizo, all the senators, assembly members, and everyone who helped make this day so great, and for all the hard work that they do throughout the year. And for more information on me, you can go to my website at victoriasamazingworld.com. Thank you.
How about that for one of our young ambassadors who's going to walk the walk for us, and she is a part of our future. On behalf of myself, all of us, all the co-chairs, Assemblyman Murray, we'd like to present you. By the way, this passed unanimously, our New York State resolution for Animal Advocacy Day, and pretty hard to pass things unanimously in both houses in the state legislature. I want to present this to you as a keepsake, and
thank you
for being a great ambassador.
Thank you.
I'm going to introduce you now because we still have duties to do today, but we have the prime sponsor of Kirby and Quigley's Lab. Just let me mention some of the people who also have done yeoman's work for us. Senator George Amador was here with us, Senator Ruman Diaz, Senator Jim Seward was with us, Senator Joe Robach, Assemblyman Kevin Byrne was with us, Assemblyman Ed Rye, I think he already mentioned, Assemblyman Mark Johns, Assemblyman Steve Otis, and Assemblyman Melitakis is here with us. So give them a round of applause. And I think we're moving forward. You're going to hear more about Kirby and Quigley in the Assembly. But somebody who's working very hard, thank you, is the Assemblyman who's carrying that, and it's Denise Crone's Assembly person. It's at the, and that's Assemblyman Angelo Santa Barbara. Assemblyman, come on up.
Thank you, Senator Tedesco. Thank you. It's great to be here with all of you. I have my dog Muffy here today. She's a little teacup Yorkie. This is her second Animal Advocacy Day that she's joined me up here at the Capitol. And this is my son's dog. My son, I have a 15-year-old son. He was born with autism, doesn't speak. Okay, everybody's awake now. So my son doesn't speak too much, but this dog is his best friend, and they don't have to speak because they have a bond. And if you see these two together, you know why Kirby Quigley's Law is so important. Denise Crone and the Crone family are here. Denise, come up here.
I'll step over the top.
Yeah. So Denise and her family have taken a personal tragedy, as Senator Tedesco mentioned. She came home one night to find that her two dogs were killed while her house was being burglarized. That is simply unacceptable. And this bill Jim introduced in the Assembly, and now I'm proud to pick it up as he has joined the Senate to fight to get this bill passed. It's so important, not only to make sure that this doesn't happen again, but to take a stand against crimes like this. This is unacceptable. Our state can and will do more. This law is how we're going to do it. We have almost 100 sponsors on the bill, and that's unheard of sometimes to get 100 sponsors on a bill. But that's just how important it is. It's important that we continue to fight for this, to pass it this year. It just passed the Agriculture Committee, and it's on its way to codes. It passed the Agriculture Committee yesterday. I'm very hopeful that this bill will become law in memory of the two dogs that the Crone family lost. But I'm also fighting because I understand what would happen, how devastated would my son be if something were to happen to his dog, Muffy? How devastated would it be? He can't speak, but I know that he would be very devastated. It might affect his entire life. That's how important this bill is. And we're going to do it this year. I know Denise has been up here every day advocating for this bill with her family, and I can't thank her enough. It's not often we get that many sponsors on a bill, but a lot of it is her work. So I want to thank you all for being here. Our companion animals need your voice. They're part of our families. Jim, you're doing a great job. I can't thank you enough. I can't thank all the people up here for joining us. And spread the word when you go back home. We can make this a bigger and a better event next year. Thank you. God bless all of you.
Jesus, adorable.
You know, Angelo has good attendance, but Denise Cronin is competing with him for attendance in the New York State Legislature. You know, I think she shows up as much as most of us do. Just so you understand this, we've named this Kirby and Quigley because it can put a face on a piece of legislation. But this isn't unique, what's happened, unfortunately, to the Crone family. The initiation, one of the things that happened to initiate this bill and why I wrote it and I sponsored it, I think I've told you this before, but some of you may not know this. There was drug smuggling taking place from Ecuador. They sliced the bellies of puppies open and put tar heroin in their stomachs. They put them on airplanes and they sent them into Kennedy Airport. They got caught. Their lawyer went before the judge and said, "We were just trying to deal with narcotics. They didn't mean to harm the puppies." Of course, they ripped their bellies open and threw them in the corner. They got no penalty for what they did for those animals. That was wrong, and I knew it was wrong. Now that wrong will be paid a penalty for if we can get this passed in the assembly. So it's an important bill, and we're going to continue to fight, and I thank everybody for supporting it. Now at this time, I want to introduce somebody which, you know, you can't find the words for anymore in terms of what he's done for animals and animal advocacy and for our safety. You know him from the Pet Connection. He's the only guy that can get every dog and every cat to sit still and look straight forward and, on his command, lick his face if he wants him to. I don't know how he does it, but sometimes when Gracie gets bad, I send him over to his house for a week and he straightens Gracie out for me, comes back a perfect dog, with kindness. He's the animal advocate's advocate. He's the best advocate we could possibly have. He's number one in my book. Steve Caparizzo, please come on up here, our Toastmaster.
You guys ready for some action now? First of all, thank you for all being here again today. It's an absolutely tremendous turnout. It seems like, I don't know about you guys, it gets bigger and better every single year. And you know, people are listening. Look at all the cameras, the reporters from different TV stations, all the posts that are going to be on social media today. So our voices are going to be heard by hundreds of thousands of people in a very short amount of time. Thank you to Senators Jim Todisco, Phil Boyle, Sue Serino, Assemblypersons Linda Rosenthal and Dean Murray for their tireless effort. These guys get it. Give them a round of applause. They just get it. You know, I walked around today and I tried to say hi to everyone because I think I just about know everybody here. The true heroes amongst all of us are the shelters, rescue, and pet first responders for the thousands of lives that they have saved in the past year. So I thank all of you, salute all of you. What we do is a lot of times not on the front line. What you see firsthand is absolutely amazing. We thank you. All right, 18 years ago, you remember Buster? I bring this up because up until Buster, we had nothing in New York State. It's hard to believe. Buster the cat, with the leadership of Jim and so many others, but mostly a grassroots effort, so many of you signed petitions, and I think if I'm not mistaken, it was a wheelbarrow, right?
Yeah, brought it in.
Yeah, 100,000 signatures, and that got the ball rolling on making animal cruelty a felony. We've come a long ways. There have been some bills that have been passed into law, but we all know we can do so much better. Sometimes we get so frustrating. We stand up here, and let's face it, we hear about all the great bills being passed by the State Senate, and I'm not belittling the Assembly, please don't take it the wrong way. It goes to the Assembly in a committee and sits there, and sits there, and sits there, and rots, and doesn't get out. That can't happen. We need that to stop. Now, I'm going to do something bold that I've never done before. Sometimes I have to bite my tongue when you're in the TV business. I ask any state senators, assembly people, to let me know personally who is holding up the passages of a law or bill, and I will post it. People in our state need to know. It can't be secret behind these marble walls. They need to know who's not listening to us. And I will let all of you know. So I challenge you guys. I don't ask for much, but I want to know who is not backing some of these bills. For example, and I'm glad this is going to pass sooner than later, the Mastiffs in Stratford and Fulton County. Now, 10 dogs ultimately died, starvation. They did autopsies on some of the dogs. They found bark and dirt in their stomachs. That's what they were eating to survive. We're talking months of neglect. To me, neglect is torture. Torture is the worst kind of animal abuse. When that animal passes away and dies a horrific death, how can that be a misdemeanor? How can that not be a felony? It makes no sense. So let's get that passed. Animal neglect. Animal neglect needs to be a stiffer crime. Now, Kirby and Quigley's law, I called it a law. I guess I'm predicting something. I hope it's a law. That's a no-brainer. Let's cross our fingers, cross our toes, that in this session it does get passed. The Animal Abuse Registry, and you know, Jim is educated, and Assemblywoman Rosenthal, on how these crimes are bridge crimes, and how we know somebody that abuses a dog or a cat or any innocent companion animal can easily abuse a person, and maybe even worse. How can the federal government, the FBI, recognize this? In our great state of New York, we brag about being the best. How come we can't? It makes no sense. The last thing I want to comment on before I get kicked off is the horse racing industry. There are a lot of people that walk around with blinders. Residents of New York, government officials, TV stations, media, they don't recognize for what it is. We're never going to stop horse racing. It's an amazing industry that generates billions of dollars and a tremendous tax base for the state of New York. I realize it's never going to go away. But what we have to get to go away is New York State being one of those states that allows the transport of horses to Canada for slaughter. That has to stop, and it's an embarrassment. It's a black eye. We are a great state. We make so much money off horse racing, and yet that still occurs. To me, that should be stopped immediately. And let me tell you something. The word is getting out there. 10 years ago, you talked to somebody about it, they didn't know about it. Now everybody's learning about it. Spread the word on social media. It makes a difference. Google it. Google horse slaughter in Canada. Post some of those links. People in New York will get the message why that has to stop. I think I've said enough. I tell you, one of the most rewarding things about my job in weather, in TV, is that I have seen such a transformation over the years. 20 years ago, if you saw one animal abuse story on the news in a week, it was a big deal. Am I right? Now you watch the news. Almost every station, once or twice a week, is covering some horrific act. The media community, and I'm part of that, is actually taking an interest and realizes the significance of it. And I said this last year, and I'll say it again. We have a chart in our newsroom, and it's probably the top 20 local news stories. And it might be a fire, a burglary, a murder, God forbid. Guess what story is always number one on that chart if we do it? An animal abuse story. People are watching this stuff. They're learning from it. And they get upset. It's an emotional thing because we can all relate to our pets. So I thank the media for that. It's so much better today than it ever was. I thank all of you for allowing me to do what I do, help pets. That means the world to me. And even when I stop doing weather, I'll still be helping pets. I want to share with you a quick video that will show that we still need to get things done. You know, we're making progress. These guys are the best. They are in the trenches with us, and I love it. But we got to do more. Share with you a video about the decapitated cat. You know that story. I think it's worth talking about that. The corgis that were recently abandoned in a home in Summit in Schoharie County. And as many of you know, we've touched upon it today, the English Mastiffs that were brutally starved to death and abused in Stratford in Fulton County. Now, it's not going to be all depressing, because we're going to end the video with our great legislatures and the song to the Pretenders, I'll Stand By You, and we get to see them with their pets and how happy they are and how they improve the quality of our lives.
Police tell me on Wednesday a man killed a cat at his home, and when they responded to the call, they found the cat dead in the yard with its head nearly decapitated. 45-year-old John Geerling is facing a felony under Buster's Law for nearly decapitating his cat, and neighbors were shocked when I told them what happened.
Just hearing this story is disheartening.
The officers responded to the disturbing call and found the cat dead in Geerling's yard with its head almost completely cut off.
We do have a case like this. It's certainly disturbing, and we do what we can to make sure that those persons are held accountable.
It's a bridge crime. People who hurt animals like this in such a cruel and aggravated way go on to hurt people.
It raises concern. It's very alarming, and I think that I hope this individual get the help that they deserve.
He is one of 11 dogs on the road to recovery. They were found in deplorable conditions.
Earlier this month, state police and Schoharie County Sheriff's Office rescued them from deplorable conditions inside the Summit home. The owner, a former breeder, abandoned them.
She wasn't in good health, and there'd been a death in the family, and she moved out and just left the dogs there.
Alone for days. Carrie Colin from Schoharie Valley Animal Shelter found some trembling in a corner, others locked in separate rooms.
The house was in horrible shape. They had no food, no water. There was no heat. The water was actually frozen coming out of the faucet in the kitchen.
But they would beat the odds. 12 days later, happy, healthy, and growing. One corgi delivering two puppies. Soon, all 13 dogs will be at 100%. And winning over many hearts.
It's going to take a lot of volunteer work getting them resocialized, getting them up to health, getting them spayed and neutered, and then putting them up for adoption.
It just smelled like death.
It looks like the dogs have had the run of the place for who knows how long.
Captain Michael Teeth says this is the worst case of neglect he's ever seen.
These dogs obviously have been outside in the cold all winter. They haven't had adequate food or water.
We were able to go to the Brennan Humane Society where the living dogs were taken for care. This male is one that's in better condition. Even so, he's about 10 pounds underweight. The dogs that have died will be taken for examination to determine the cause of death.
They died an unnecessarily painful death, and it shouldn't have happened.
And still, one female dog continues to wander the property, too scared to come near any human.
It breaks your heart.
So sad, the tears are in your eyes. Come on and come to me now. But don't be ashamed to cry. Let me see you through. 'Cause I've seen the dark side too. When the night falls on you, you don't know. Do nothing you confess could make me love you less. I'll stand by you. I'll stand by you. Won't let nobody hurt you. I'll stand by you. So if you're mad, get mad. To me now. Hey, what you got to hide? I get angry too. Well, I'm alive like you. When you're standing at the crossroads, don't know which path to choose. Let me come along. 'Cause even if you're
see, there's no shortage of love for animals with my colleagues in the New York State Legislature. And also with us was Assemblyman Braberneck right here. So give him a round of applause. And Assemblywoman Deborah Glick, I think, stopped by before. So she's got several bills. Now, Steve is going to introduce Denise. But before we do that, you know, there's not much more we can do for Steve to thank him, to show our appreciation, but every year I like to give him a copy of our New York State resolution in honor of the fact that he has been here every single year and every single day to support us. So, Steve, I want to present this to you. And, get the evidence.
Thank you, Jim.
Thank you.
Jim, I appreciate it. We all do this because we love to help pets and make a difference. There's no doubt about it, and I think it's wonderful. This lady, we've mentioned Denise's name several times today. Denise Crone has been tireless in her efforts to get Kirby and Quigley's bill passed into law. It was a tragedy that we hope never happens to anybody else in the state of New York. But if it ever does, we want these people thrown in jail for two felonies. Double everything and pay the price. Denise Crone, big round of applause.
Well, good morning. I'm almost afraid to speak because every time I move, my puppies catch my eye and they want to bark and come up here. So if they do, just pardon them. As a matter of fact, I might as well introduce them first. This is Teddy Crone, and she is actually Quigley's sister. Quigley's breeder reached out to us and gave us Teddy from a litter. And Teddy's father is Quigley's father. And her name is Teddy, which I named after Jim Tedisco. So, T-E-D-I. Porter is another golden doodle that was also given to us by a breeder about the same time. They're still puppies, just barely a year. And he's what they call smooth golden doodle, different breeder, different family, looks totally not like a golden doodle, but these two are inseparable. So we welcome them, and they have been a saving grace to me many days. I am more than honored to be here speaking. This was a journey that I had no intention or ever thought that I would be on in my wildest dreams. But it has probably become one of the most important journeys I've ever been on in my life and my family's life. My husband is here today with me, Patrick Crone, my sister Michelle, and they are the two my biggest advocates. They have my back. They're down here, one or the other, every day, helping advocate for the Kirby and Quigley bill. This assemblyman, well, now he's a senator, Mr. Jim Tedisco, and Santa Barbara are also my driving force. I could not ask for more support from two most genuine people you could ever ask for. And then to get even deeper than that, the people that are standing up on the stage, the people that we watched on that video, they have our backs. They believe in what we are fighting for, and it is going to happen. To refresh your memory, because some people maybe weren't here last year, and just to kind of lightly go over it, Jim has talked about it, Steve has talked about it. The thing about the Kirby and Quigley bill is that it really has been around for 12 years. In my advocating, people have said to me, well, you have to put in due diligence. It's only been around for 2 years. So I did my homework being a retired school teacher, and it has been around for 12 years, but it was always just a number. So what keeps me going is that through my dog's death, this bill came alive. It came alive because my dogs represent what is a heinous thing that happens to the animals. Nobody in this day and age should be able to get away with murdering a dog and having nothing and not being penalized for it. The Kirby and Quigley bill would make it a Buster's Law, animal cruelty law felony, punishable with 2 years in jail and a $5,000 fine for harming a companion animal during the commission of another felony. This enhanced penalty ensures that perpetrators are charged with felony animal cruelty charges when they face other felonies as a burglary. Right now as it stands, I will never forget the day after this happened, the sheriff said to me, Mrs. Crone, we're very sorry, but we want you to understand, if we catch the criminals, they are not going to be charged with the murder of your dogs. It'll be the burglary. And what I say to that is, I go home and I cry every day, and it's not about the jewelry. It's not about the TVs. It's not about the electronics that were stolen. It is about my family members, my animals that were murdered. And yet, as you heard Dean speak about it, they are nothing but property. They're nothing but your corner table, your iPod. That's all it's considered in the court of law today. And we know, as advocates sitting there, that that is not true. What this bill will do, so when you go in and hopefully advocate for this bill also, it ensures that it's prosecuted as its own separate felony. That's all it does. We already have It's already a felony. Buster's Law makes it a felony, but now it just doesn't get bundled in, or what I call it gets, you know, plea bargained in with a harsher crime. It has to have its own indictment. They have to be charged separately for the murder or death or whatever cruelty is done to that animal. Right now, as we talk about the bridge crime, the crime at our house has been reported to the FBI. That's how serious it is. The FBI looks at it more serious than our state laws. So now it's time to make it happen. Now is the good part. Last year I came, I think if you heard me talk, I was pretty upset. The codes committee had voted it down, so it was dead. It wasn't going anywhere. And it was very devastating. Well, as of yesterday, I'm telling you, the fire is burning in my belly, and I hope the fire burns in your belly, to go and talk to every assembly person that I have on a list. Before, in January, the Senate passed this bill 59-2. 59-2. As of yesterday, in the New York State Assembly, and this count has gone up every hour, as of this morning, 90 assembly members are co-sponsors. 90. So hopefully we all have done our math. 76 is a majority. So we are well over a majority today. If we went to the assembly floor today, it would be a law. But I also have to explain, when I got into this last year, it was after the Senate had made it, it passed the Senate. And I thought, oh, this is a piece of cake. The Senate passed it. And then reality hit me. I forgot how a bill becomes a law. So we worked. The Ag Committee passed it last year. It has to pass the Ag Committee. Then it has to pass through the codes, which it didn't. This year, as of yesterday, 20-0, it passed in the A committee. Once again, majority. Now for me, this is probably what I have worked at the hardest, and to me is the most exciting, is that as of yesterday, in the codes committee, there are 22 members on the codes committee. As of yesterday, 12 had committed themselves as co-sponsors of this bill. Do the math. Every step of the way, it is a majority. Today, and I may be late for this meeting, I have a meeting with the Speaker of the House's counsel. I hope that they're listening, because right now as we speak, we do know we can go all this way, and yet one or two people may make the decision that this is still not going to become a law. When the majority of our assembly people are telling and listening to everybody here in New York State make this a law. So I'm hoping that they will see that right now it's in the swing, majority, in my mind, rules. Our work is far from being done, and I hope that as you leave today, being a teacher, I make my lists, and then I make some more lists, and then I lose them, and then I have to go make them again. So where I'm at now is I have tried to see almost every single assembly person. Right now, at the desk, I have a list, and it's changed. Dean Murray came up to me and went through this list and crossed off 5 more assembly people that are now co-sponsors. We have about 50 left on this list that I've either talked to just once or I haven't been able to get to. And that's where you people have to come in and help. Pick up the list. Their phone number's there. You're here today, and I'm telling you what I've learned as an advocate is eye to eye is what matters. Phone calls matter. Last year I wrote 300 emails, 300 snail mail letters, and you know how many replies I got? Zero. Zero. But when I started coming down here and walking the halls and going in and talking and telling them my story, and then they would say to me, how can you talk about it? If I don't talk about it, it's forgotten. If I don't talk about it, it never happened. This bill, if it had been a law and they had caught whoever did this to my family, they would be penalized for what they did to my animals. But I know if they catch them today, it's not going to affect them. And that's what hurts. You tell your assembly people, if they don't approve of this law or they don't back it, That means that you're telling the criminals, go out and commit whatever felony you want, because you know what? While you're doing it, go ahead and shoot up a couple dogs. Go ahead and injure an animal, because guess what? They're just property. It's not going to matter. We don't want that anymore. You guys have to stand up, go advocate a little bit, let them know, support this bill, and we're going to do it this year. We've got the backing. And I thank you. I thank you from the bottom of my heart. My family thanks you. We're going to do it. I went off script a little bit.
You know, I've been here quite a while. I started in the assembly, and I've been in the assembly for the 6 month now, for the first 3 or 4 weeks. When they walk down the hall and people say, hi, Senator, I was looking over my shoulder like this. I thought they were talking to somebody behind me. I finally got adjusted to being a senator. But one thing I found out here, there are very powerful elements in the New York State Legislature and on the second floor. Very powerful elements. They scare me sometimes. They don't scare me enough to keep my mouth shut. Because when they scare me enough to keep my mouth shut, I pull the covers over my head and I don't come to do this job anymore. They don't scare this lady at all. Let me tell you something if you want to talk about courage.
No, they run the other way.
She says they run the other way, yeah. And I believe her. Yeah. This is courage. This is what representative democracy is all about. How can we as legislators, how can we have over 90, the majority in the codes committee, and not get that to the floor and pass that? With your help and her courage, we're going to get this done. On behalf of the New York State Legislature and all animals, I want to present you with this. Thank you for your courage. Thank you very much.
I'm just going to add one more thing. There's days that have been really tough down here, and this is what's amazing, where whether I am so upset, and I know that if I walk into Senator Tedisco's office, his staff, whether Jim's in a meeting, he'll come out and be like, you're doing good. Just, you know, don't give up. Or I go into Assemblyman Santa Barbara, his staff is there. Like, it's just been an amazing experience. And then I can go home, and when I feel really bad, I just turn on and watch Steve Caparizzo. So, you know, those are the perks. But that's the thing, people, they work for us, and they want to. People want to do what's right. So they've got to hear from you, and that's what I found out. I've had the arguments. There's some people, believe me, there are assembly members that are dead set against making any law harsher. I give them props. Tell me to my face, but don't lie to my face. And that's one of the things that I really will say, most of them come to that. And I have to respect, if they're protecting criminals, someone's got to, I guess. I don't know. I don't feel that way because, you know, once you've been, you know, violated, that's just not in my, you know, my nature. But there are some great people. Go up and talk to them. Even if they're not your assembly person, that's the thing, is they all work for us. So I could keep going on and on, but me and you could have a battle of talking.
Back to Steve.
Absolutely. All right, this next group I want to introduce you to is Operation At Ease. Give them a round of applause. I had the chance to help them out in my own little way, not a lot, but I'm so impressed at what they do. I'm going to let them explain to you what Operation At Ease does. But basically, they take a rescue and work their magic and turn it into something that can truly help a veteran, which I think is absolutely beautiful. I want to introduce Joni. Come on up from Operation At Ease. Give her a round of applause. What they do is magic, and it saves pet's life and a person's life. Joni, thank you.
Thanks. Hi, guys. Thanks for having me here. I'm Joni. I'm with Operation At Ease. We are a nonprofit organization that takes dogs from shelters and rescues. We pair them with disabled veterans, and we provide a free 6-month guided training program for the purposes of PTSD and light mobility service dogs. I started this group about 2 years ago simply because there wasn't one available for our veterans. I was looking for a group for a friend of mine who needed a dog out in Seattle. I called several different organizations and was found that the waiting list exceeded 2 to 3 years, or the veteran themselves could pay $20,000 for a dog. We have a million dogs euthanized every year because there aren't enough space. There aren't enough homes. We lose, I'm sure some of you have heard on Facebook, the 22 push-ups for 22 veterans. So it's estimated that 22 veterans a day commit suicide from PTSD. And that number is wrong because we have a very high veteran population in Texas and California, and they don't report their suicides to the VA. So it's higher than 22. So with losing 22 plus service members daily for PTSD and a million dogs every year, we decided to start Operation At Ease. We've taken dogs from APF, we take them from Mohawk Hudson, we work with a couple groups throughout the United States, and we're able to do both. Our veterans come to class, one of them is here with me today, with her shepherd. And they really should get all the credit because they do all the work. We're not a traditional service dog group. I don't give trained service dogs to veterans. I match a veteran with a dog, or they use their own dog, and then they come to class for 4 consecutive months. And then we go out and do public access training for 2 consecutive months. And they have to pass a series of 3 different tests before their dog is certified. We've taken dogs from hoarders. Some of the cases we've heard today, we took a golden retriever who was covered in urine and feces, who we had to completely shave down and matched her with a veteran in Massachusetts. They just went to the beach. So we've taken dogs from the kill list at those high kill shelters in North Carolina and matched them with veterans up here. So anecdotally, our veterans say it's easier for them to be in places like this with their dog. It calms their anxiety, it takes the attention off of them. It gives them a reason, coming to class gives them a reason to leave the house. So we are able to do both. So thank you everybody for letting us come, for inviting us. We appreciate it. Thank you.
Today we're mindful that we thank our servicemen and women for everything we hold dear. Yes. And certainly we thank this service organization who is providing them the service to keep them and have the ability to acclimate back into our society. On behalf of the New York State Legislature as a memento, I'd like to present you one of these animal advocacy resolutions. And God bless you for your service, and God bless you for your service.
Thank you so much.
Amazing, right? I want to take this time to introduce Nathaniel Fields. Come on up here, the CEO of Urban Resource Institute in New York City, over here. I thought you were over there. You must have done a loop around
me.
And he's going to talk about the connection, we've talked about this morning, between domestic violence and animal cruelty, in the unique shelter that these folks have for people and their pets, which I think is absolutely awesome. Nathaniel, come on up. Thank you for being here.
Well, thank you. Listen, I love being in a room with advocates because our energy is just tremendous. Our compassion and our ability to get things done really just unparalleled. So don't prove me wrong about our energy, because I want to hear it. I want to make sure you're still with me here today. A little more. With that energy, we have a means behind me of such dedicated electeds that are going to continue to build upon all of the great ideas and work that we put forward to them to actually continue to get it done. So let me talk a little bit about Urban Resource Institute, and forgive me if I brag a little bit about what we do. We are one of this nation's largest providers of services to victims of domestic violence. I work with over 350 people. Some of them are right over there. Give them a hand of applause, please, around. And this work is hard work, but rewarding work. Listen, look around the audience. 50% of people know a victim of domestic violence. In our great nation, 2 out of every 3 women right here in our state, right in a nation, are murdered each year as a result of intimate partner violence. In the wars of Iraq and Afghanistan, we lost over 6,500 brave soldiers from 2001 to 2012. And do you know, during that same time, we lost twice as many, nearly 12,000 women due to domestic violence. Really difficult. You know someone that's a victim of domestic violence. Two out of every three women are killed as a result of domestic violence. And let me tell you why we're talking, why I'm here today, because I want to talk about pets. And I want to connect what we're doing here today to victims of domestic violence. Listen, pets have moved from the backyard to our kitchen tables into our bedrooms. We know they're part of our family. And what we realize, right, without any pretension, we are expert with working with victims of domestic violence, but we learned a lot with working with the animal welfare community. We realized that many victims of domestic violence, over 48%, said they would not leave an abusive relationship because they weren't going to leave their pet behind, right? They knew that if they did, over 70% said their pet would be threatened, harmed, or murdered. We talked to national experts, we talked to survivors, and this was true. We heard horrible stories around the state. We heard stories, people calling us and said, hey, because we know domestic violence is about power and control. And just like what we've heard in terms of the relationship between pets and people, that power and control is also manifested as a result, as it relates to pets. We heard a story from a victim at the time saying, I was out, I got a phone call from the abuser. He said to me, if I didn't get home in a few minutes, I have your cat, and I know you love your cat. Your cat's in the microwave. You have X amount of time to get home, or I'm going to turn that microwave on. And I don't say that to shock you, but that's the real deal stuff that we deal with at Urban Resource Institute. In New York State, we had not one domestic violence shelter in the city that allowed for people and their pets to live together. We thought this was just horrible. We knew, we heard the stories, we heard the statistics, and we had to do something about it. So we created the first, 4 years ago, we created the first ever innovative program where people and pets, victims of domestic violence, fleeing abusive relationship, and their pets can come into shelter. And the same way we provided services to victims in terms of holistic and comprehensive, we did it with pets. Pets would come in, we would assess with our vets, they would spay, neuter, microchip, our lawyers would work with getting them on protective orders. Our pet therapist would come in because they've been exposed to trauma, to look at the impact of trauma and restore the family to a higher state in terms of their healing. Just remarkable work. Jasmine, who's on the left of me right here, is so strong, and she's a survivor. She comes out, she's part of our work to partner to say that the thousands of people and their pets being impacted by domestic violence and nowhere to go, she's not one of them. She was part of our services. She had two pets who are part of her family, Tony and Teresa. And I know, Jasmine, you're here, but I just want you to just say maybe a word real quick in terms of what that experience was for you. Yep.
Hi.
Yeah.
Really quickly, I'm very honored to be here today among so many people that are like-minded. It's very difficult to find, in some places that I go to, people that have that understanding of the bond. I don't want to go through the whole story just because of time, but essentially about 2.5 years ago, I entered URI, Urban Resource Institute, with a broken left ankle and my two dogs, and I wasn't sure how I was going to start over again. And they helped me with the basic blueprint of what it's going to look like, not just for my own healing, but also for the healing of my pets. And I was well cared for during the time that I was in URI. I was never uncomfortable. It was just like having my own place with my animals with me. And so, you know, I was successful in finding an apartment. I was successful in returning to school. I'm going to Silverman School of Social Work. Well, my pets are healthy. They're happy. They feel safe. They play. And so, you know, but these things that people take for granted on an everyday basis are things that people like me, or survivors, dream about. Peace and quiet, safety, being able to be with your animals without worrying about their safety, and just walking them, basic things that people take for granted every day. I can do that now safely and happily. And I'm, you know, so very grateful that I'm here today, not only advocating for the URI, but also just in general advocating for people that are still out there and need those services and are afraid to reach out because they don't want to lose their animals. They don't want to be separated from their pets because they're not just pets. they're part of your family. They're very important. So thank you for having me today. Have a good day.
So real quick, you heard Jasmine. There's been great work done. There's more to be done. We need more regulations. We need funding to build more sites where people can bring their pets into safe environments. And we're going to talk to the folks behind us. And as advocates, we're going to be tireless in our advocacy. We're going to hold folks accountable. And what else are we going to do? We're going to get it done. Thank you for your time. Thank you.
How about a hand? Domestic violence is a serious concern in our state.
You may have seen some of the canine units walking around. Pretty cool, right, to see those dogs for sure. I want to recognize Saratoga County Sheriff Michael Zerlo, who was here earlier, but unfortunately, the guy has like 9 things going on today, so he's running every which way. But thank you to the Saratoga County canine units and the Schenectady County canine units that have been here today walking around. They're awesome to see. I want to introduce, some of you have met these unbelievable rescues and four-legged friends. They're kind of like the stars. Whenever I'm in a room with them, I want to be with them and we all gravitate towards them. Rich Nash, can you come on up? Big round of applause with Hudson. I hope you guys all got a chance to spend some time with Rich Nash. Marie Shelto and Junior, Bacher Jr. We lost Bacher, and Junior is doing great. Fritz, how many people met Fritz, the miniature horse? From Littlebrook, right? Where's the owl? Where's the owl lady? She said she wanted to come up here. And can I introduce Lori LaMonaco and an amazing rescue. If you haven't talked to Lori, please talk to her Tuesday. Come on up. These are some truly important people. By the way, you would never know this. Tuesday is totally blind, has a birth defect on the front leg, was tied to a tree for 10 years. So we thank Lori for saving Tuesday. It's an amazing story. Big round of applause to these guys. Are they great? Thank you, guys. Appreciate it. Now, before I forget, Jim and I want to remind all of you, before you leave, what are they going to do, Jim?
We're going to pick up the, if you haven't got a folder, please pick up one of the folders with all the pieces of legislation in it to contact your legislature and your legislators in support of these bills. That's why we're here, to educate, to support these bills and get them passed. And after we're done here, we're going to take the picture again. So we got the evidence that we were all here for the 7th time right up on the steps. So stick around for that.
Yeah, we don't want you guys running out. So don't run out when we're through. Special thank you. Let's hold the applause till the end. We've met a lot of these, but I want to thank them. Obviously, all the shelters and rescue groups, the humane societies that showed up today. Denise Cronin and her advocacy and her family and what they have done to get Kirby and Quigley's law or bill into law. Joni Benilla from Operation At Ease. Nathaniel Fields, who we just spoke to us, we thank him. There's the owl. Hudson, I guess, has a fancy for owls.
I guess, and usually she'll hoot when she sees an owl.
Come on, quickly tell us about the owl. We're all interested. Come over to the microphone. We're not going to hear you. You got to yell.
I got to yell? Okay.
And don't hoot.
I can yell. I have a loud voice. Hi, I'm Joyce Perry from Whispering Willow Wild Care in Schenectady. This is a barred owl, B-A-R-R-E-D. His name is Jasper. All of our birds have been injured, and they cannot be released into the wild, so we have special licenses to bring them in to events, and we do a lot of school programs. We want people to see our owls and our other birds because we really have to think about conserving habitats for these lovely birds. And I want to thank the senators and assemblymen and Steve for having us here and thinking about wildlife today, too. Thank you very much.
Thank you. When you see a bird of prey up close, they're absolutely amazing, right? Absolutely gorgeous. Susan Wagner from Equine Advocates, I want to thank her. Victoria Bonavita, where's Victoria? She's an amazing, amazing young lady. We applaud you for what you're doing. Yeah. It starts with the young people. You're absolutely right. They're 100% of our future. Is Cassie Hayden here with Nimmy and Oliver? I want to thank my good friend Denise James and John, two amazing people that are voices for the voiceless. We thank you for your dedication. Michelle Riggi, Jamie Roberts. Jamie, stand up, will you? Come on, stand up. And this is the bravest, strongest, most dedicated woman I have ever met. She's fighting cancer, but she fights for the animals too at the same time. She's battling everything, and she's winning. Julianne Tanner. Stand up, Julianne. She's the lady that keeps us updated on everything that's happening in New York State. So, Julie, thank you so very much. My buddy, Donna Farnsworth. Well, you know, we say Donna's from Pet Connection, but she's like my sister, or my second wife, as my wife would say, right? Todd Kramer, Mike Buckley, Marguerite Pearson from the Mohawk Hudson Humane Society. Deb Belay and the APF, we thank the APF. Jason Hayes from the Saratoga County Animal Shelter. Brian Shapiro from the Humane Society. Val Lang Walden for all her work on behalf of homeless animals. Sue McDonough from NYSHA. Kathleen Caller for putting together the list of rescues at the registration table. Kathleen does a great job. Make sure you check it. Is Nancy here? I'm not sure, but I wish I could see this lady again. It's been a while. Nancy Bonesteel, Buster's mom. We thank her. Nancy and Jim, of course, they got it going. Don Feathers, who inspired Sky's Law to add horses to Buster's Law, which is so important. And again, thanks to all of you, because it's you that make this happen. Not us, it's you. So thank you. Congratulations on a great turnout. Jim Todisco, Senator, my good friend, one of our heroes. Jim, we thank you.
Thank you.
Up the stairs.
Good timing. We're only 5 minutes late. Want to thank all of you for what I know you're going to do, not only now, but in the future. And once again, I want to thank the Senate staff for the wonderful job they've done here today, and the Assembly staff, primarily our Senate workers. How about a round of applause for them? Thank you, staff.